So, good morning, everyone. I'm Florian Dupuis, and I work in Météo France. And today, I will talk about calibration of ensemble forecasts using convolutional neural networks. And just to start, we know that solar panels and wind turbine energy production rely on meteorological conditions. Because when there is sun or wind, it's possible to produce electricity. But when it's cloudy or it's night or when there is no wind, it's not possible to produce electricity with solar panels and wind turbines. And so in order to manage the production of energy, it's important to forecast the power that will be produced by these means. And to do that, we need a weather forecast. And weather forecasts are made with numerical weather prediction models. They are based on an approximation of physical processes, of the physical processes involved, which means that the equations solved in these models are simplified, and they are not representing all the complexity of the processes in the nature. And moreover, these equations are resolved on a grid of the order of dimension of the kilometer. And so it's just an approximation. And also, these models are based on initial conditions, the analysis, and boundary conditions that are an approximation of the real state of the atmosphere. And so when we make a deterministic forecast, in fact, we get a solution which is dependent of these simplifications and approximations. And so on the left part of the figure, we have the analysis, which is the starting point of the forecast. And when the forecast is done, we get a solution, which is dependent of the simplifications and approximations, as I said. And the idea with ensemble forecast, it's to make several simulations using a modified state of the initial and boundary conditions. So on the figure, we see in the left part, it's the starting point of the simulation. And we see that we have a different starting point for all the simulations. All the starting points are very close because we modified just a bit the initial conditions, but they are a bit different. And we also modified the equations a bit. And so when the forecast is done, we get several solutions. And in fact, the dispersion between the different simulations gives an information on the uncertainty of the forecast. In fact, the more the dispersion, the more the uncertainty of the forecast. And it's an interesting information that could help to manage the production of electricity. However, the raw ensemble forecasts are not calibrated, which means that they are biased and that they have their dispersion is not realistic. Which means that the magnitude of the dispersion is not really linked to the uncertainty of the forecast. And so we have to post-process this ensemble forecast, and that's what we call calibration. And there are several methods to make a calibration, but the most popular one is called EMOS, and it allows to correct the bias and the dispersion of the raw ensemble forecast. To use this method, we have to impose a shape of the distribution, which is formed by the ensemble of the solutions. Another way to make a calibration is to make a Pankine regression. And in this case, we have not to make any hypothesis on the shape of the distribution. And the Cantile regression can be done by, for example, by using random forests or linear regressions. In the bibliography, we see that there is no difference of performances between the methods, between these methods in the calibration of the global horizontal irradiation, which is in fact the solar radiation, that is a variable that we want to correct. And in fact, all these methods have a common point, which is that they are not specifically designed to process two dimensions data. And that's why we have an interest for deep learning methods, and particularly for convolutional neural networks, because they are specifically designed to process images, but they can also process any created data. But despite of these characteristics, very interesting, convolutional neural networks are not very much used to post-process weather forecasts yet. So I just put two examples of studies. The first one it concerns the post-processing of the deterministic forecast of nebulosity. And in this study, the convolutional neural networks produced better results than more traditional methods. And in the second paper of Veldkamp et al., the authors shown that the convolutional neural network produced better results than traditional methods for the post-processing of the ensemble forecast of wind. And so the objective in this work was, in our work, was to calibrate the global horizontal irradiation ensemble forecast using these deep learning methods, the convolutional neural networks. So we used 1 year of data, it's the year 2018, and we used the ensemble forecast called PEARP, which is the ensemble forecast of the ARPEGE model. In fact, it's one of the operational ensemble forecasts of produced by Météo France. And it contains 35 members. In fact, that means that there are 35 simulations that are run. And so we, as I said, we work with a 3-hour mean global horizontal irradiation. It's the parameter that we want to correct. And we work with a forecast starting at 18 hours UTC each day, and we work with lead times from 3 to 48 hours. And we also use the ARPEGE deterministic forecast for additional parameters, and we also use the geographical features. And in order to train our models and to evaluate the results, we used the data from the CAM dataset as a ground truth. And from the CAM dataset, we used the global horizontal irradiation at 0.2 degrees of horizontal resolution. The data are available over Europe, only over land and not over seas and oceans. And these data are derived from satellite observations and model outputs. And the dataset is freely available on the link, this link. And so for the strategy, so we compared two methods, the convolutional neural network, as I said, and we used the UNET architecture, which is a very famous architecture, which gives very good results on plenty of different problems. And so the second method is a more simpler neural network called multilayer perceptron. As predictors for our models, we used some quantiles and the minimum and maximum values of the GHI from the PEARP forecast. And we also used other parameters from the deterministic ARPEGE forecast, for example, the cloud cover at some levels, because of course, cloud cover impacts directly the solar radiation. And we also used some fluxes classical weather parameters like temperature, relative humidity, wind components, and also some geographical features like altitude, latitude, and longitude. And the objective was to calculate 35 quantiles. And to do that, we used we searched to minimize the pinball function. And we run one new training for each lead time. And for the evaluation, we mostly use the continuous ranked probability score because it's the more popular metric to evaluate weather forecast the probability weather forecast. And in fact, this metric is based on the difference between the cumulative distribution functions of the prediction and of the observation. And so now a few results. So on the right, you have the maps of the mean, yearly mean of the CRPS from, for the raw PR forecast on the top, for the CNN in the middle, and the skill score at the bottom. And so what we see, and the objective with the CRPS is to have the values as low as possible. And so what we see is that with the CNN, we have a decrease of the CRPS, which means that we have an improvement of the probabilistic forecast. And it's generalized to the whole domain. And another thing that we can see is that we have maximum values of CRPS over mountains. And in fact, it's caused by higher values of GHI values over mountains, which is obvious, in fact. And now just one more thing. So we see, for example, over the Alps, in the PERP that we have a maximum of CRPS, meaning that we have a maximum of errors over the Alps. And when we look at the dispersion, the quantile intervals, which informs on the dispersion of the forecast, because when we have high values of quantile intervals, that means that we have a high dispersion. And so when we look at the dispersion, we see that over the Alps, we have a minimum of dispersion. And so we have, over the Alps, a maximum of errors and a minimum of dispersion. And it's something not very good. Because, in fact, as I said earlier, the dispersion represents the uncertainty of the forecast. And so when we have high errors, we expect to have a high dispersion. And that's not the case in the PERP forecast. But when we look at the CNN forecast, we see that the interval quantile over the Alps is a maximum. And we see that when we compare the map of the CRPS and the map of the quantile interval, all the maximums of CRPS correspond to local maximum of the dispersion, which is something which is a good result. And now, just to finish, I show you there the comparison between the convolutional neural network and the multi-layer perceptron, which is the simpler neural network. And so we can see that both methods have better results than the PERP forecast. And we can see also that the convolutional neural networks has better results than the simpler neural network. Especially during the middle of the day. And so we see that the CNN is better than the neural network. And on the right part, we see the CRPS skill score for different lead times, for events 15, 18, 21, and 24, which corresponds to 9 hours UTC, 12, 15, and 18 hours UTC. And we can see that for all the lead times, we have an improvement over the world domain. So now to conclude on the results. So the GHI of the PR forecast is calibrated using a convolutional neural network. The convolutional neural network produces better results than the simple neural network. And we saw that the high dispersion in the convolutional neural network output always corresponds to high errors, which was not always the case in the PEARP forecast, for example, over the Alps. And so it's a pretty good result. And now for the perspectives, we also have a large ensemble of 512 members that were generated with the WERF model. And calibration is in progress for the solar radiation. But the results are not very good for now, probably because the data set is too small, because we have only 6 months of forecast. And we know that with these methods, the amount of data is something very important. And secondly, we also work with wind speed. And for that, we used the arpeggio analysis as a ground truth. And for that, the calibration is in progress too. And I have finished. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Florian.